Let's get started then on chapter 17. Just taking a minute to warm up. Sorry. Whitney, can you see that from there? Is this in your way? Shouldn't be, right? All right. Okay, chapter 17 is called Job Order Costing. It's actually a very descriptive name, but it doesn't make sense until you start figuring out what job order costing is, and then you're like, oh, that's why they call it job order costing. So a job in accounting, and I guess they want you to see the learning objectives first, so before I just start jumping into it. So we're supposed to distinguish between job order and costing and process costing. We'll record all of the entries for this type of costing. And then this part number three, the predetermined overhead rate, this is the part that confuses everybody every year. So that's a part you'll want to take some notes, okay, and make sure you understand it because it confuses people. I'll, like, warn you when we get there, but, like, this is the part. And then record the completion and sales of finished goods, adjust for this part's also confusing, allocating and over-allocated overhead, and then part six is dumb, super easy. So it's three and five, those are the problems for most people. All right, so first thing here. So we've already learned in chapter 16 that our product costs have to get accumulated into the products as we're producing them. This is very different than a merchandising company like we learned about in financial accounting. When we're creating something or manufacturing something, we have, instead of one inventory account, the stuff we bought from the supplier, we've got three inventory accounts, right? We've got our raw materials, that's the stuff we bought from the supplier. Then we have work in process, that's raw materials that we've also put labor into. And we've also put overhead into all of those costs involved in running the factory, but that we can't necessarily put onto any one product. We've pushed that all into the work in process. And when we finally finish whatever process we're doing on it, it moves into finished goods, which is our inventory of stuff that we're going to sell, stuff that we started with as raw materials, put effort and labor into, and now it's become something different. Okay? So we've got to track those costs all the way through the system because at the end of the day, we've got to know the cost per unit or the cost per job. Okay, when we talk about job, that means each unit we create is a job. So we need to know the cost because they help us set the selling price instead of just guessing what our selling price should be or basing it on what our competitors are doing. We want to know what the cost is. We need to know our cost of goods sold. We need the cost of inventory so that we have accurate balance sheet and other records. All right. So this is silly, but it's true. McDonald's needs to know exactly how much it costs to make a cheeseburger, especially when they're putting stuff on the dollar menu, right? They've got to know. They're running really thin margins on those dollar menu items. So they've got to know. It's not even now it's a value menu, right? So that, like, the McDouble is like $1.79, and I'm like, wait a minute. My bad. How about a spicy chicken? I still a dollar? Yeah. You're not a lover of the spicy chicken? Oh, he's one of those guys. I don't eat McDonald's. Cause I don't eat McDonald's because I don't like the way I feel afterward. I like. Yeah, it's guilty, and this sort of heavy sense in my midsection. Like, oh, I shouldn't have done that. All right. Anyway, you get the point, though. All of these different companies have to know the costs of their products, okay? All right, so here's job order costing. A job is a production of a unique product or specialized service. It may be one unit or a batch of units. That's a job, okay? The reason it's kind of broad like that, one unit or a batch of units, is it depends on the nature of the company and what they're producing. Some things are produced in batches. Other things are produced one at a time. So we use this for companies that have unique products, and the costs are accumulated by job. Okay, so whether that's by the making of one unit, like say a car, cars are produced by the unit, or in a batch. As opposed to process costing, where you have a company that just makes a bazillion identical units. Then we accumulate our costs by the whole process, and we just pretty much come up with an average cost per product. Okay? Yeah.
So is that sort of like what you were talking about, your knife making friend, where is 400 knives, those are a job, but the other sort of regular knives are more of a process?
Okay, so yeah, I mentioned the guy who makes the custom knives. So when he would make a custom knife for somebody, each knife would be a job in and of itself. When he would do the semi-custom, he would make, say, a dozen of those at a time, and so maybe that whole batch of a dozen would constitute a job. Does that make sense?
Oh, so it still counts as a job.
Yeah, that's still job order. Somebody like Coca-Cola Bottling Company might use process costing, because they're going to produce millions of bottles of Coke, and they're all going to go through the same process. And so it's not as important for them to know what any one bottle of Coke costs. They can just say, we made a million, it costs us this much, divide a million by this much, and our average cost per unit is this. And that works for their scenario. But with a custom knife, he has to sit there and say, okay, I put this much steel into it, this much deer antler, you know, all of these things that go into it, and know exactly how much it costs, because he's going to be selling it on that basis. Does that help a little? Okay. So how do we record the material and labor costs in a job order costing system? So this chapter is about job order costing, even though it told you what process costing was, just to show you the difference. All right, so we already saw this concept in chapter 16. We use what they used to use what's called a job cost record to document the product cost for each job. So this looks a little confusing, but you'll see they have like job number 27, direct materials, direct labor, manufacturing overhead. Job 28, those all go into the work process inventory by job. So in essence, what you do is you create, if you remember the term from Accounting 1, a subsidiary ledger. We use subsidiary ledgers in Accounting 1 for things like accounts receivable. Even though we just keep an account that shows how much is owed to us, we have a breakdown, a subsidiary ledger, that shows how much is owed by each person that owes us something. In this case, we would keep one book for work in process inventory, but we'd have a subsidiary ledger that breaks down by job how much of that. So if you know the balance of your work in process inventory is $100,000, you would have another ledger that would break down that $50,000 was from job 27 and $25,000 from job 28 and $25,000 from job 29. That's all that means. Okay? Once we finish it in work in process, it flows to finished goods. And then once we sell it out of finished goods, it flows to the income statement as cost of goods sold. Okay? So we'll go through this step by step. So it's pretty normal when a company purchases raw materials that they'll store those materials for future use. I mean, it'd be awesome if you could just get what you need exactly today for production and not have any storage costs. But in real life, that's just not a perfect world, and so you'll store some things. We use materials in our production. Some are direct materials. Remember, direct materials are materials that we're putting directly into the thing we're manufacturing, and we can tell you exactly how much. We also use indirect materials. So a good example of that might be that if I'm building a house, I might know exactly how much lumber goes into the house. Those would be direct materials. But I don't keep track of every single nail. So I know I'm buying materials and nails, but I just sort of lump those all into something called indirect materials. I know I got to put a bunch of nails in, and this house might have, 1,000 more nails than this house, even though they're the same size, because of all sorts of things. If you've ever pounded a nail, you know that sometimes they don't pound quite right. They hit a knot and they bend, and you got to grab another nail or whatever, right? So that's an indirect material. So if we purchase materials, here's how we record it. We do a debit to our raw materials inventory account. That's an asset. It's an inventory account. And a credit to accounts payable. Or if we'd paid cash for those materials, we'd credit cash, right? So that's the first one. During 2008, they purchased raw materials of $367,000 on account. That's easy. We can do that transaction. Here it shows how it's broken down. They received 200 units at 55 apiece, $11,000. I think this is a little confusing. These are units of raw material that they issued, usually to the work in process department, and there's a balance in the account. Okay? Don't worry too much about these little exhibits. I don't think they're helpful. In the olden days, what would happen, though, is when a production department would need some raw materials, they would walk over to the raw materials desk, or maybe it was a warehouse, and say, hey, I need 15 B103 batteries for the project I'm working on, for the job I'm working on. And then the raw materials office would give them the batteries. They'd fill out this little form that showed these batteries are going to job number 27 and who it was requested by. And that cost would be transferred then, think of the journal entry, from raw materials, which would now be credited, and work in process would be debited. So it's moving it from raw materials to work in process. Okay? Now it's done similarly. There's probably still a warehouse somewhere because you still have to have physical goods to move from one place to another. But usually what you do is you come over, you've got a name badge, they scan it, and then they scan the product, and that's it. Right? It's not a physical form that you carry around from place to place. It's just each time, you know, you work on a job, your barcode is assigned. And a lot of times the job has its own barcode too. So they scan the job barcode, the raw materials, and then your barcode to show that you're the responsible party. You take those back, you add them to, you scan it that says you're done, and you move it down the line to the next part of the production process. And that happens fast. It's not like I just described it. A lot of times, if you ever get a chance to tour like a working automobile manufacturing plant, it's insane how quickly they can roll a car down a production line and go from raw steel to a finished car. It's pretty amazing. It's worth checking out. All right. So let's get to the next transaction. So in 2018, Smart Touch Learning used direct materials costing $355,000 and indirect materials costing $17,000. The $17,000 of indirect materials are transferred from raw materials inventory to work in process through the manufacturing overhead account. So this is an important point you need to learn now. Anything that is indirect materials, indirect labor, is going to go to something called manufacturing overhead. Also, other things like, we've already learned about it, the utilities on the plant are going to go to manufacturing overhead. The salaries of the plant manager is going to go to manufacturing overhead. The depreciation on the manufacturing equipment is going to go to manufacturing overhead. All costs that are part of production but are not direct, meaning you can't tell exactly which product they go into or which job they go into, are overhead. Okay? That's important. Let's see. Let me go back to that. So what do? We debit work in process inventory, $355,000. We debit manufacturing overhead, $17,000, and then we credit raw materials inventory. So the raw materials inventory account is dropping, going down, and these two accounts, their inventory accounts as well, are going up. This again shows the old-fashioned certificate for it. I think it's more confusing, so I'm just going to move past it. Now that we have the raw materials moved into the work in process department, they incurred total labor costs of $197,000, of which $169,000 was direct labor and $28,000 was indirect labor. So work in process inventory gets $169,000 charged to it. That's a debit. Manufacturing overhead gets $28,000. And then the wages payable account, that's because we paid the people, gets credited. Okay. Remember, all finished goods are just a combination of raw materials and labor, and then the overhead costs that get divided up. That's all things. The value of the finished good comes from the value of the stuff that you started with, the work you put into it, and then all those other costs involved in doing that work. which is the overhead. All right. Remember I said objective three was the one that gets confusing for people? So just pay attention here. Calculate the predetermined overhead rate, or the overhead allocation rate, and allocate overhead costs. So here's our problem. We don't know how much overhead we are going to have until after the fact. It's not till the end of the year where you say, hey, I recorded all of my utilities expenses and all of my depreciation expenses and my manager's salaries and then all those indirect materials and indirect labor. I recorded all of those. And at the end of the year, you can say, this is how much manufacturing overhead I had and this is how many products I produced. So I can tell you now how much my overhead per product was. But you don't know that till the end of the period. So what you have to do is at the beginning of the period, so you can have a decent estimate, working estimate of your product costs, is you have to make a guess, an educated guess, by creating what's called a predetermined overhead rate. So this company had, in addition to the things we already put to manufacturing overhead, they had three more things: depreciation on the manufacturing plant equipment, or four more things, plant utilities of $7,000, plant insurance of $6,000, and plant property taxes of $5,000. So they went ahead and recorded all of those things. They all went to manufacturing overhead. Those are all costs of producing the product, but that we can't put on any one job or any one product. Okay? All right. This is all the things I just said. So the way we come up with a predetermined overhead allocation rate is we assign something called an allocation base. And the allocation base is based on the primary cost driver of producing the product. So some products are very labor intensive. So we would use our direct labor hours or our direct labor cost as the cost driver. Others might be machine intensive. So we would use machine hours. How many machine hours go into the producing of all of our products? Then what we can do, let me see, they don't show very, very well on here. So what we do is we say, we estimate for this year we're going to have a certain amount of overhead. Usually what we use for that is last year's, right? We think, hey, if we're going to produce about the same amount as we did last year and our overhead was $1 million, we'll use that as our estimate of overhead for this year. If we say, hey, last year we produced this much, we think we're going to produce 30% more than we did last year, we would adjust that and make an estimate. Okay? So this is how we apply overhead throughout the year. So if we estimate $1 million, and then we have to choose our allocation base. For one project, we might say direct labor hours. Again, we like that because we can have a pretty good estimate as to how many direct labor hours we're going to put in this year. Okay? So you say, we believe in this upcoming year, we're going to have 10,000 direct labor hours. So it's just an estimate. In real life, you have an accountant, a managerial accountant, working together with the production manager. The production manager probably goes down to the line supervisors on the production line and says, hey, how many hours do you expect it's going to take us to do this over the next year? Okay, so they create an estimate. So in a book, it's just going to have to be given to you. In real life, there would be some discussion between management and the line supervisors to make a reasonable estimate. Or at least it should be. In real life, a lot of times, someone gets pressed for that number, and they don't do their job of going and talking to their line supervisors, and in the end, they just throw a number out there, right? That happens a lot in the real world. All right, anyway, so let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that would be... So our manufacturing overhead rate, predetermined overhead rate, is going to be $100 of manufacturing overhead for each direct labor hour in this scenario. Based on the fact that we believe we're going to have $1 million in overhead for the year, and we believe we're going to have 10,000 direct labor hours. So then what we can do is for each job, we can apply that estimate, because we know how many direct labor hours went into any given job. So we can take that rate and apply it. I'll show you, hopefully we'll show you an example here that will help with the concept. All right, so Smart Touch Learning's total direct labor cost for 2018 was $169,000. Using an overhead allocation rate of 40%, manufacturing overhead is $67,600. That makes no sense to me. We'll do the example in a minute. So what they do is they record work in process inventory, $67,600. So they had come up with a rate of 40%. So they base their manufacturing overhead on 40% of their direct labor costs. Okay? So they took the $169,000, multiplied it by 40%, and that came up with the amount of manufacturing overhead that they're applying to their jobs. This is kind of the things I just said. Manufacturing overhead is a temporary account. So we have to have a zero in manufacturing overhead at the end of the period. This is important right here. A debit in the manufacturing overhead account signifies that our actual overhead was greater than our allocated overhead. So remember, we make an allocation base, an estimate at the beginning of the period that we can apply to jobs. And then at the end of the year, we've been keeping track of our overhead throughout the year and keeping track of the amount that we're actually allocating through the estimate, and there'll be a difference in the two. Okay? A debit in that account means that our actual overhead was greater than the allocated, and a credit would be the opposite, that the actual overhead was less than the allocated overhead. We'll come around to it in an example. It'll make more sense. Okay, record the completion and sales of finished goods. So after accumulating, assigning, and allocating the cost of direct materials, direct labor, and overhead to jobs, a company now can account for the completion of the jobs and account for the sale of the jobs, etc. So the $64,600 cost of goods manufactured is the cost of all jobs that they completed during 2018. They transfer that to the finished goods inventory. Okay, so it started with raw materials. It went to work in process. We put in labor. We put in overhead using our overhead rate, which is an estimate of the amount of overhead that we're going to have for the year. And then we take that and we transfer it by debiting finished goods inventory, another asset account, and crediting the work in process inventory. Then we sell the stuff. We sell $1.2 million on account, so that gets recorded as accounts receivable, $1.2 million debit, and sales revenue, $1.2 million credit. Now, do you guys remember that whenever we sell something, there's two things that have to happen, two different journal entries? One accounts for the retail sales price, what we sold it for. The other has to account for our cost. Right? We've got to reduce the inventory by the amount of stuff we sold, and we've got to record that as cost of goods sold. Because we didn't sell it at our cost, right? Hopefully we made a profit here. So we had $1.2 million in sales, and the cost of all jobs that we sold was $584,600. So we record cost of goods sold of $584,600, and we reduce our finished goods inventory by $584,600. That's the process. All right. Now, we have to adjust for over-allocated or under-allocated overhead. So we made this estimate that we were using throughout the year to apply our overhead. In this scenario, they took 40% of direct labor costs. And so for each job, they would say, okay, what were the direct labor costs on the job? Multiply that by 0.4, and we'll put that amount as manufacturing overhead on the job. Okay? So as they did that, they kept a ledger of the amount of manufacturing overhead they were applying. Also, as they actually spent money on manufacturing overhead, paying for the plant, electricity, paying for the salaries of the plant director, etc., as they did those things, they recorded on the credit side of the balance all the actual costs. And in the end, they end up with a balance. Underallocated overhead occurs when actual manufacturing overhead costs are more than the allocated manufacturing overhead costs. So you get to the end of the year and you're just comparing them. You're saying, here's how much we allocated based on our allocation approximation or our predetermined overhead rate. Here's how much we actually spent. What's the difference? And what's easy about this is if you're not sure how it works, you're going to have a debit or a credit balance at the end of the year. And you always close it out to cost of goods sold. So if you've got a debit balance, then all you would do is credit the account that amount, and it would take your manufacturing overhead to zero, and you would debit cost of goods sold. If you had a credit balance, all you would do is debit the balance, manufacturing overhead, to bring it to zero, and credit cost of goods sold. So it's not super hard to do, but it's a little harder to understand what you're doing. Okay? At the end of the year, you make an adjustment at the end of the period that brings manufacturing overhead to zero and transfers whatever balance, whether debit or credit, to the cost of goods sold account. Okay? So, the credit to manufacturing overhead is $15,400 at the end of the period. So what do they need to do? Well, if they have a credit balance of $15,400 in manufacturing overhead, So they had a debit balance of $15,400. So they credit the account $15,400 to bring it to zero, and they debit cost of goods sold. And that's it. Okay? So it's confusing. And like I always said, if you can learn the what first, how to do it, then the why of doing this comes. Okay? Michaela. For what account? So manufacturing overhead it's a temporary account that doesn't really have a set normal balance. I guess it would be a debit balance, but it really can have either, because all it is like this accounting of our actual cost versus our projected or our estimated cost, and at the end of the year, it's going to have some balance, and you have to return it back to zero by closing it out to cost of goods sold. So it really could have a balance on either side almost any time. Yeah. So in this case, let's see. So we had a debit balance to our manufacturing overhead account, right, of $15,400. So you figure each time I do an entry, with manufacturing overhead, when I apply my manufacturing overhead, I apply it to the credit side. When I record actual overhead costs, I apply it to the debit side. So in this case, I had more actual than I had applied, which means that I under-applied. Does that make sense? It's confusing. And that's why I try not to dwell on the terms as much as the process. Because you could talk yourself into, circles. So if I didn't pay enough, that's under-allocated. Instead of just saying, look, I've got a balance of 15.4 here. I've got to close it out. So the way I do that is by crediting it $15,400 and debiting cost of goods sold. You think if I'm debiting cost of goods sold, I have $15,400 in additional costs that I hadn't accounted for through the process. Right. If it had been on the other side, if I'd had a credit balance, then I would debit it, and I would credit cost of goods sold, which would reduce my cost of goods sold expense, which means I have $15,400 fewer costs than what I had allocated throughout the period. Makes sense, kind of, right? It's confusing, but the process isn't horribly confusing. That's what I'm saying. This one, actually, it's kind of easier to learn the what and kind of know how to do it, and then as you do it more, you're like, oh, I know why this is happening now. All right. So here's this big exhibit on how the manufacturing overhead account is adjusted. I actually really like it. It's in the book. So before the period, you calculate a predetermined overhead allocation rate. During the period, you apply or allocate that overhead rate. And at the end of the period, you compare how much you allocated versus how much you actually spent, and then do an adjustment to bring them into line. And that's really all that we're doing. As crazy as it sounds, that's it. So you estimate it up front. You allocate it during the period. At the end of the period, you now know exactly how much you did spend, and you can compare the two. All right, so here's a summary of all the journal entries we just went through. I'll just flash through them real quick. Again, if you want to watch it, you can check it out, or if you want to look through the book, this is all in the book too. And then there they are as T accounts. and then a schedule of cost of goods manufactured, which we already learned how to do in the last chapter, but it started with the beginning work in process inventory. It added, actually, so the direct materials used started with the beginning raw materials, added our purchases, it gave us the amount available, we subtracted out what was left over at the end, that told us how much we used. Then we added in our direct labor, we allocated manufacturing overhead, that gives us our total manufacturing costs. Then we subtracted out what we had left in work in process, and that was our cost of goods manufactured. It flows pretty nicely, it's just getting accustomed to the way it flows, right? And then the income statement, same thing, we had our sales revenue, less our cost of goods sold, gives us gross profit, and then all the expenses which we wouldn't have had access due to this problem because it didn't give us all the selling and admin expenses. All right, the last objective in the lecture, calculate job costs for a service company. So service companies don't have inventory or manufacturing costs, so they're easy, much easier, okay? So really, if we have direct labor, we put it right to the jobs, and then we allocate the overhead the same way. Think of a company like, a dentist, okay? They don't manufacture anything, most dentists, okay? They just do service. So they do have direct labor costs, probably the salary of the hygienist, the salary of the dentist, and then they have other costs that would be directly related to them providing their service.